So we will go ahead and officially get started with our program here. Okay, so what is conservation, first and foremost? Conservation is acting to protect or save resources and also using them correctly. So if you are thinking about conservation and the kinds of things you could protect or save, go ahead and share with us what some of those things might be. So what resources or what things could you yourself be conserving? Go ahead and share that with us in the chat. I'm sure we will come up with a lot of ideas here. Animals are definitely a good one. That was one of the very first ones I saw. We think about water conservation a lot. We might think about saving energy, so being able to conserve energy as much as we can. So right in our own homes, we are able to conserve things such as water and electricity pretty easily. Those are quick things for all of us to be able to conserve because we can turn off a faucet when we're brushing our teeth. We can make sure we don't accidentally leave a hose running if we're saving water. We can also turn off lights when we leave a room or unplug devices that we are not using. And we might, if we expand that out a little bit, if we're thinking about other types of water conservation, we might think of keeping waterways clean or disposing of our trash properly so it doesn't end up in a waterway. I also see forests. We can definitely conserve forests or other habitats. So conserving land is very important, not only for us, but also for all of the animals that need that space. We might have resources we are using from those spaces, but there are a lot of other species that are using those as well. So we've got some great suggestions on all the different things that we can conserve in our own homes or in our backyards. For the zoo, we are working to conserve or protect wild animals and wild places. So those are kind of the big things for us. We do conserve on site at our zoo. So we conserve things like water, electricity, and resources. But we also work globally to conserve wild animals and wild places all around the world. And the great thing is that conservation action can happen everywhere. We talked a little bit about what we can do in our own homes. We talked a little bit about what the zoo might do or how the zoo might do that. And today we are focusing on conservation that happens kind of halfway around the world from us, specifically with a project called Anteaters and Highways that we are a very proud partner of. So Anteaters and Highways works in a region in Brazil called the Cerrado. It's the big grassland habitat of Brazil. It holds a lot of different species, and it is very far away from us. So you can see here with that graphic, the Cerrado is in that lower eastern part of Brazil. So even though it is very, very far away from Tucson, it is really important for us to be knowing what's going on there and protecting that space because anteaters and many other animals call that space home. Now, this particular project is working with how the Cerrado is being used. So about half of the Cerrado is being developed for human use. That includes ranching and farming, people's homes, roadways, lots of human activity in that area. And the more humans there are in that space, the less space there is for anteaters. That also means that there are fewer resources for them. So it makes it less safe for them or more difficult for them to be able to get to food, water, and shelter that they need to survive. Also to get to each other in order to be able to reproduce and have more anteaters that will help support the population. Their major focus for the Anteaters and Highways program is to study how the anteaters are moving in their habitats, because the more they know about how an anteater uses its space, the better able they are to go ahead and protect them, to find ways to make sure that those anteaters can get to all the resources they need and that they can stay safe doing so. Now, it's not only important for us and for researchers to know how anteaters use their habitats, but it is also sometimes important to know why they are doing certain things. So we're going to take a look at this picture here. This is a beautiful picture that came from our Anteaters and Highways partners. And this is of a mother anteater and her pup out in one of part of the grassland. So mom is in the front, her pup is right behind her. If you look really closely at mom, you might notice that she's wearing something interesting. We will talk about that in just a little bit. But in looking at this picture, in looking at their habitat, I want everyone to think about and share with us, why would this mother anteater and her pup want to cross the road? Now, if you have jokes to share with us, those are absolutely welcome. Please share those as well. So why would a mom and her pup want to cross a road? To find food, absolutely. That is definitely a big reason to have to cross anything. You need food in order to survive. So being able to find food resources is important. Sometimes finding each other, that's a really important one. It might be mom trying to get to her pup if they became separated. It might be a male and a female trying to find each other. Certainly to get to the other side, that's gonna be the best joke we have. Why did the anteater cross the road? To get to the other side. Sometimes we may not know exactly why they did it, it's just that they did. So why did the anteater cross the road? That is what the Anteaters and Highways Project is trying to answer. So in addition to all these other questions that they are working on, why did the anteater cross the road is a big part of their focus to try and help these animals out. Now, in order for researchers to study this, there are a few different ways to do that. One of those ways is going to be by using wildlife tracking cameras. So this is a researcher installing a camera on a tree. Those wildlife tracking cameras are critical because animals don't behave the same way in front of us as they would naturally without any human interference. So installing a camera is a really nice way to make sure that we're not bothering them, we're not disturbing them. And those cameras can give us great images, such as this one. We have a lone anteater here coming right towards the camera. And we also, in this photo, have a mother with her pup on her back. That is something that we do occasionally get pictures of, just kind of out and about researching anteaters, but wildlife tracking cameras allow mom to not have to worry about the potential predator in her space and just behave the way she normally would. So we might get a chance to see her and her pup much more closely than we would if it was humans in her space. Now this particular tool is a great way for scientists to get an estimate of a population, to be able to track babies and how they're growing. It might also tell them what other species are living in the area. Anteaters are also active at night, so having a camera out at all hours of the day and night helps a lot. Now in the previous photo on our other slide, you might have seen, if you looked at the mother anteater very, very closely, she had kind of a lumpy appearance. That is because she was wearing a special GPS harness that has been designed for giant anteaters, just like the one in this photo. And if you take a look at my video screen, so where my face has been, go ahead and take a look at that, and you will notice that I actually have a GPS harness in my hands. This was given to us by our partners at Anteaters and Highways once the anteater who wore it was all done with it. So this belonged to an anteater named Kyle that was being studied. And over time, these GPS harnesses will either stop working or they will naturally fall off, depends on the type of technology and the type of attachment you're using. This was one that they were able to probably just go ahead and catch Kyle up, safely anesthetize him, so give him a special medicine to allow him to sleep for a little while, and then cut the harness off so that he could go on his merry way or potentially replace the harness so that way we could get more information if we needed it. This particular spot here is where all of the data is going to be. So this is where the computer is that tells us that very valuable information. And these straps fit around the anteater, similar to the way a dog or a cat harness would fit around our dogs and our cats. So GPS harnesses are a great way to be able to follow animals from a safe distance, again, without bothering them. Now these two researchers here are using the radio telemetry that allows them to track the harnesses, because you can't typically just walk outside and find an anteater. You have to find them from a distance and then see how close you can get to monitor what they are up to. So the radio waves are a great way to be able to try and detect them across miles and miles and miles of either open grassland or bush or forest where you may not be able to see them as well. Now, occasionally we do have the ability to study deceased animals, and studying deceased animals is a really valuable tool to understand what might have happened. In this particular instance, we do have an anteater that was hit on the roadway. That is a very dangerous thing for a lot of animals. Roadways have a huge impact on native populations, and for anteaters, they need to cross roads very frequently throughout their habitat in Brazil. But by studying the animals that have passed, we can get information about their biology, we can draw blood samples, we can take hair samples, we can potentially find out how they died, and sometimes find out a little bit more information about how they lived. And finally, another tool that we have to be able to study these animals is to rehabilitate them and release them back into the wild. Sometimes anteaters do get themselves injured, or they might find themselves in a place where maybe other humans do not want them there, maybe it's not a safe place for them. So researchers can occasionally go in, rescue those animals from those situations, or get them recovered from an injury. They take care of them, they fit them with that GPS harness, then they release them back out into their habitat so that we can study how we can better protect them. Now the next slide you are going to see is going to be some data collected from a GPS harness on an anteater named Christopher. So all of these data points that you are seeing, the red dots and the red lines, that is following Christopher the anteater's activities over the course of about 2 months. So this is him throughout his habitat. The aerial photo is showing his entire home range, and you might notice over off to that upper right corner, there's a lot of dark space up here. So we've got some natural tree cover, possibly some wetland areas, but then we've got these very clean cut areas down here that don't appear to have very many trees at all. That is because those are ranches and farms that take up the vast majority of this habitat's home, or of this anteater's habitat. Down in this lower third of the photo, you might notice there's a roadway. He has to cross that road many, many times to get to whatever he needs on each side. And over the course of the about 2 months this data was taken, he crosses that road over 30 times. So researchers want to know, what is it that drives anteaters to put themselves potentially in a dangerous situation in order to cross that roadway or put themselves into close contact with people? We have another fun part of the research we can do, some of the data that we collect. This is a video that was collected from a camera trap, because camera traps not only provide photos to us, they can sometimes provide videos. Before I play this though, I want everybody to take a guess. Give me your best guess on whether or not you think an anteater can climb a tree. So go ahead and type that in the chat, yes or no. Because it's a guess, there's no wrong answer. We will find out momentarily. We've got no way. Got a couple, yep, no, they belong on the ground, they live on the ground. Couple of yeses because they've got big, powerful claws. Let's find out. So as this video plays, oh, absolutely, if they are being chased, definitely. So as this video plays, you'll notice that the anteater is going to be able to wrap their claws around the tree to be able to lift themselves and get all 4 feet off of the ground. Now, I don't know if that quite counts. I would say yes, it does. I don't believe anteaters can climb maybe as well as a jaguar can climb, but they can get all 4 feet off the ground. Oh, and it looks like our video is not showing. Let me see if I can back up and try again. We'll see if we can start that over. Apologies to everybody. So spoiler alert, the anteater did get off the ground, but we'll go ahead and play the video again. So anteaters do also mark their territory so they can claw that tree. We know they do it, but we don't always see how they do it. So this camera provided that for us. And as you can see, pulls all 4 feet up off the ground. Now, he doesn't stay there for very long and he doesn't get any higher, but he made it up off the ground. So camera traps provide wonderful videos for us, things that we might not ever get to see without that camera. But they can also provide us with photos of very special moments or very cool information. So this particular photo here, this first one, is of a mother anteater and her pup. And for this, we can look at it and infer that she might be grooming her pup, she might be playing with it, she might also just be getting it to hold still, because as any human mom knows, as most animal moms know, sometimes you just need to hold your kid still in order to make sure that they are staying where they're supposed to stay. But this is a neat moment that we would probably not be able to see in person. Camera traps can also capture natural events. This camera captured a fire in the grassland where it was installed, and I believe it actually took pictures right up until the camera was destroyed by the fire. So it's a really important thing for researchers to know what might be happening in that area in order to know how they can support the animals that still need that habitat, determine what resources might be missing, and how that area would need to be able to recover. We can capture other animals that might be similar to the ones we're trying to study. So these are two giant armadillos. We have a mother and her pup here, and mother armadillos will spend a lot of time with their offspring, just like giant anteaters spend with theirs. And armadillos and anteaters are kind of in the same group of insect eaters or insectivores. So similar animals, they occupy the same habitat, and they actually have cool relationships that help each other out. We can also see if there are relatives of an animal in an area. So this is a relative of a giant anteater. They are called tamanduas, or lesser anteaters, and they are much better climbers than their giant anteater cousins. But this one took some time to wander around on the ground and stop and pose for a photo for us. We can also see if there are predators in an area. This puma or mountain lion is in the same habitat that giant anteaters occupy. Very well could be a predator of a giant anteater. But it's important for researchers to know everyone in an area so they know how many predators there might be, if there's enough food for those animals, and what the distribution is of those animals. So where are they in their habitats? It will capture unrelated animals as well. So this is a neighbor of an anteater. This is a brocket deer that is coming up for a closer look at the camera, trying to figure out what it might be. And sometimes our cameras capture maybe more than one thing at a time. So in this image, everybody look closely and use the chat to tell me what you think you see here. We do have a couple of different animals in this. If you're looking in that lower right-hand part of the screen, we have a crocodilian species. That is a caiman. And then in the upper part of the screen, this larger animal here, is an animal called a tapir. Tapirs are an animal more closely related to horses, even though it doesn't quite look like it. And here at Reid Park Zoo, we have Baird's tapirs. Not quite the same as this particular species. There are a few different types, but Baird's tapirs do look very similar to this tapir right here. And then we have that little dwarf caiman down in the corner. It's a cool animal interaction we may, again, not have seen otherwise, because this photo was taken at night. Now, why is conservation important to us? It's important for a lot of different reasons, but one of the most important reasons is that it preserves the diversity of animals, plants, and their habitats. That biodiversity is what helps keep our planet healthy, and it maintains the balance of life. We're all connected to every living thing and to the environment that we share this planet with. And conservation, so conserving species, helps keep those connections healthy. We need each other in order to survive. It also teaches us how to live alongside the species with which we share space. So conservation can lead to campaigns such as this one that allowed a big billboard to be put up on the side of the road in Brazil. So Brazil does have very high traffic areas. It has lots of highways. And this sign over off to the right side of the roadway was installed to let drivers know, hey, you're sharing habitat with a really special animal. Slow down, pay attention, know that these animals share our space too. And conservation also helps us save little lives like this one. This was a video that was sent to us by our Anteaters and Highways partners. This little lady was rescued. Unfortunately, her mother was killed, but one of the great things about conservation is that we can step in and preserve life. We can try to make sure that these animals have a future, and we can get wonderful videos to share with everybody about why it is so important to save these animals. So this is a little female. Her name is Sue. And she is going to be rehabilitated. She's going to be raised in an area where she is separate from people, not dependent on people. So she gets to learn how to be an anteater, and she gets to hopefully live a very long, full life. And she'll give us lots of information about how we can protect all of her wild cousins and everybody that comes after her. Now that is the official end of our program. So we want to thank you so much for joining us today and spending some time with us. We loved having you and hope that you enjoyed learning a bit more about anteater conservation.